Hi, I'm Ernie Zohr, and in this video I'm going to demonstrate Basic Ohio Probate Forms version 8 by completing a set of forms for a small probate estate. The app is up on my screen right now, and what you're seeing is the main window. The left side is the tree view, and it outlines the process for completing the forms. I'm going to follow that outline by starting with step 1, completing the general information worksheet. What you see on the right side of the display is the form window, and the first form you see is the general information worksheet. It's the logical place to start working because it contains much of the basic information that's repeated on all the other forms, like the case number, case name, the decedent's name, address, that sort of stuff. By the way, although I'm starting with the general information worksheet, you can display and complete any form or worksheet in any order. But, as you'll see later, it makes sense to follow the recommended order. Now, I've begun completing the worksheet so you can see how it's done. Basically, you tab from field to field and make your entries. You can't see it in this demonstration, but normally some fields would already be completed, like the attorney and the judge fields. That information comes from the default file, which you can customize so that every new file you start has those fields completed already. It's handy, and there's a YouTube video, separate YouTube video, about the default file. Check it out. It's only about 5 minutes long. Now that I've completed the top section of the general information worksheet, I'm going to stop, and instead of having you watch me, I'm going to open a file that I've prepared that has the general information worksheet already completed. And like I said, that way we won't need to waste time as I complete each of the 50 or so fields on the general information worksheet. All right, now that it's open, I'm going to scroll down the form slowly so that you can get an idea of what type of information the worksheet contains. And with that, we will move on to step 2, which is completing the next of kin worksheet. You click this button up here to display the kin worksheet. And the kin worksheet is not only for next of kin, it's also where you list beneficiaries and other interested parties, even insurance companies, stock transfer agents, or appraisers. You'll notice that the surviving spouse and the applicant from the general information worksheet are transferred automatically to the kin worksheet. Our example has a surviving spouse and 2 children. And in this case, because one child is co-executrix and is transferred to the worksheet automatically, I only need to enter the second child, which I will do right now. I'll just put in the relation after this. Put daughter in there. Okay, now here's the neat part. Basic Ohio Probate Forms version 8 lets you send any or all of these 3 individuals to any or all of the forms listed to the right. All you do is check the box. Watch, I'm going to show you. I'll check these boxes right now. To send the spouse, Joanne, to the front and back sides of Form 1.0, I'm going to click on 1.0F and 1.0B checkboxes. That stands for front and back. Joanne's signature is also going to be required on the Notice of Probate Form 2.0, so I'm going to check that box. The Application for Authority to Administer, which is Form 4.0, I'll check that box. The Notice of Inventory, Form 6.0, and the Waiver of Notice of Hearing, Form 13.7. At the same time, I may as well send the 2 children to the required forms. You can see how quickly that is. I just click to another person in the worksheet and then click those same check boxes again. I'll do it for the 3rd daughter right now. Okay. For now, you'll have to take my word for it that the forms I'm checking are being automatically completed, but you're going to see that for yourself in a moment. By the way, if you're ever in doubt about the complete name of a form, you can right-click your mouse on the label next to the checkbox and the complete name of the form will appear in the pop-up window. And that brings us to step three, completing the asset receipt worksheet. This example we're working on has household goods and furniture, a few bank accounts, some stocks, and a parcel or two of real estate, and in addition, some miscellaneous property. I'll press the asset worksheet button so I can get started. And incidentally, I'm calling it the asset worksheet, but it's really for any asset, receipt, or income. You'll find that the asset worksheet is not very different from the KIN worksheet. I'll enter a parcel of real estate, and I'm going to paste in the legal description that I had in Notepad so I don't have to type it all in. And there we go. As I complete the additional fields, you will note the Select Distributees button. Let me give a value in there and just give it a good value. There we go. Good enough. And let's go down. I'm going to click on the Select button. And you'll see that a dialog pops up, and it contains a list of people from the KIN worksheet. This list can be used to designate any one or group of persons as beneficiaries or transferees. Now, earlier I mentioned that it's a good idea to follow the TreeView's recommended order, and this is a good example. If I had not completed the KIN worksheet first, this list that we're looking at now would be empty. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to check Joanne, and I will close this dialog and go back to the worksheet. Okay, one thing about the asset worksheet is that there's much more information to be entered when you compare it to the KIN worksheet, and therefore, due to the limit of how much we can squeeze onto a screen, in order to access all the fields, there are set buttons to the far right for entering additional information. Now watch. I'm going to click on the Send to Set button, and this is how easy. This is like the KIN worksheet now. I'm going to send this real estate to Form 4, Application for Authority to Administer. I'm going to click the button for Form 6, Inventory. I'll click the button for Form 12, Application for Certificate of Transfer, which also includes the certificate itself, and Form 13, Fiduciary's Account. There. Like the KIN worksheet, if you right-click on a form number, you're going to see the complete name in the pop-up, so there's never a need to be memorizing or trying to trouble yourself on, gee, what's Form 13.7? You can tell just by right-clicking on it. Okay, I'll close the Send To dialog and return to the worksheet. Also, like the KIN worksheet, all these forms were completed when I checked the boxes. However, there's an additional step that's required for some forms, and that additional step is categorizing the property. That's so BOPF8 knows whether an item is real estate or a vehicle or a grand piano. I'm going to click on the Category Set button right now, and I'll choose a category for the forms that require it. Now, you don't need to know which forms require it, nor do you need to know what the appropriate categories are because they're different from each form. BOPF8 has all that stuff right here in this dialog. All you need to do is make the selections. And I'm going to make selection for Form 4, Real Property, for Form 6, Real Property, for Form 13, Real Property. And again, what that does is it tells BOPF8 what category to put this piece of real estate in. There, that's it. I'm going to close the category dialog and return to the worksheet. And you'll notice that there's a real estate button where I can enter additional information about the real estate. Most of that information isn't required for the forms that we're completing now, so I won't get into that. Again, the reason that you categorize an item is because some forms, like the inventory and the account forms, and even Form 4, they subtotal the property according to what category it's in. So BOPF8 needs to know that information. Now, there are about a dozen items of property in this estate, and I've already shown you how to enter one. So to save time, what I'll do right now is I'm going to close the worksheet, and I'm going to open a file that I prepared in advance so you don't have to watch me enter more items, because all the items are entered the same way anyway. And having opened that up, I'm going to click on the asset worksheet now so you can see the completed worksheet. There's everything. Now, I'm skipping a few things like confidential personal identifiers and distributions in kind, and I'm doing that in order to keep this video short. So let's move on to step 4, completing the expense worksheet. Having learned how to make entries on the kin and asset worksheets, you won't see anything new on the expense worksheet. I'm going to click on the expense worksheet button now so you can see it, and I'm going to enter the first expense. And you'll notice as I do this that the list of forms to which expenses can be sent is much smaller than it was on the asset worksheet, so everything's right in view and you don't need to click on a button to see additional fields. Now again, to save time, after I complete this entry, let me put in the amount and I could check it off for 13.1 in the send to area, and I can even pick a category just to show you. We'll pick debts and claims perhaps. Okay, and there's nothing more really to fill out that as far as expenses are concerned, and so I'm going to open a prepared file that has additional expenses. And I'll do that right now. And let's click on the expense worksheet button so we can take a look at, there they are. And that should be good enough to see how everything goes. And the next thing is step 5, which is time and services worksheet. Now, completing the time and services worksheet is optional. It can be used for general record keeping unrelated to BOP F8 or to complete the application and judgment entry for attorney fees. This worksheet is the same as the others, only it's simpler to complete, and I'm going to skip it entirely, which brings us to completing and displaying the forms. Now, when you display the forms, you'll see that for the most part, they are already complete. In some instances, a form may require additional information that's not in the worksheets. An example is Form 1.0, which I'm going to get on the screen right now. We'll take a look at the front side and scroll down to the bottom of it, and you'll see that there's a couple check boxes there, and we can check one of those boxes depending on the circumstances of the estate. I'll place a check mark in the first check box. And incidentally, I can either click on it like I did right there, or I can get to it and press the space bar, and that'll toggle the check mark on and off. Now, this indicates that the spouse is the natural parent of one or more of the decedent's children. As I mentioned regarding the general information worksheet, a good way is to proceed is to tab your way through the form. That way you won't miss anything that may need your attention. Once I tab to the bottom of the page, like I did right there, I will use the paging button now to get to the back side of the form. Now you're going to see the names are already on it, and I can tab my way through to get to the bottom of the form again, and I'm going to check the box labeled "The will is not subject to charitable trusts." And that's it for Form 1.0. I want to prepare more than Form 1 though, so let's review the list, and you'll see that some forms like 1.0 have one or two things that you've got to do additionally. Other forms like the inventory and the account are just about completed in their entirety, and there's nothing for you to enter. It depends on the form. Let's take a quick look. Let's look at Form 2.0, application to probate will. On the front side, there's really nothing to complete. It's done. Let's go to page 2, the back side of the form. Yeah. Pretty much nothing to complete again. I could check one of the boxes underneath the signature line on the certificate of waiver, and you know, I might click fiduciary. Other than that, that form is done. Let's take a look at Form 3.0, appointment of appraiser form. I think what I'll do is I'll check the box to appoint an appraiser. I could even put an appraiser's name in there, like Joe Appraiser. How's that for imagination? And finally, I can check the box to accept the auditor's valuation. And other than that, that form is done. Let's take a look at Form 4.0, the application for authority to administer. On page 1, I'll check the checkbox for the will was admitted to probate. A little farther down, I can check the box that says no bond is required. There we go. You know what? That's about it for 6.0. Let's take a look at 6.1, and you'll see that on 6.1, there's actually nothing. Nothing to do. It's completely filled out already. And for continuation pages, they keep right on going. We won't go through all that now. We will go in a little bit, but let's take a look at Form 12.0, Certificate of Transfer. I think there's three pieces of real estate in here, and that's why the dialogue is popping up. I'll just pick up number one right now. And basically, the only thing I have to do is, like, check the box that says the decedent died testate, which is the second one down. And that should, when I tab off of it, it should fill in the date of death. Yep, that's what it does. And I could fill in the date that it was admitted to probate. I don't think I'll bother with that right now. Or, yeah, okay, I'll put a date. How about July 4th, 2018? And let's go to page 2. As I scroll down, I don't really think that there's anything to do with page 2. So let's take a look at 12.1, the actual certificate of transfer. And again, there's more than one to choose from, so I'll just take the first one. I didn't pick out any transferees. I should have done that, but I didn't. But the meat and potatoes of the certificate is the backside. Let's take a look at page 2. And there it is, legal description all in there, nicely formatted. Let's go to Form 13.0. And again, this thing is just, it's completed in its entirety, unless you were doing a partial account and you had to fill in these other things. Otherwise, there's nothing to fill out. Let's take a look at 13.1, the backside. Let's take a look at that because it'll show you that all the totals have been totaled up in the various appropriate categories. And let's move on to Form 13.1. That's the final account. It's more than one page, so it gives us a choice of what page we want. And there it is. We kind of double-spaced it to make it look nice. I think they look better like that. And there you go. And finally, let's go to Form 13.7, the waiver of hearing form, and you see that Form 13.7 is completed in its entirety. If there were 20 names there, they would all show up automatically there. And that brings us to the last step, which is Step 7, previewing and printing the forms. Now, the print button prints what's on your screen. However, the file menu has a print command that brings up a select forms dialog, and you see several pages of checkboxes. I'll bring it up on the screen right now. There we go. There's several pages, and you would note that the form that's on your screen is already checked. By checking any additional boxes, I can batch print a whole set of forms. So I'm going to check the boxes for the forms that we've just been talking about. Let me go to tab 1. I'm going to check for Form 1.0 and Form 1.0B and Form 2.0, 3.0, 4.0, 6.0, 6.1, 12.1, 12.0, 13.0, 13.1, and 13.7. Now, watch what happens when I click the print button. I'll bring it up front and expand it so you can see it better. What you're seeing now is a word processing document which contains all of those forms that we mentioned. It looks great. All the forms are ready to be signed and ready to be filed. I'm going to put it, let me put a different view on there. Can I get two pages up there at the same time there? That'll make it easier. And I'm going to scroll through so that you can see. Of course, now that it's in Word, you can save it as a PDF file. You can attach it to an email to your client with instructions to review and print it out and bring it to court with them. Or you can spell check a legal description. Or you can make a marginal note to the judge or magistrate. Anything is possible. Word also accommodates the more advanced functions supported by your printer. That would include printing non-sequential pages, duplex printing, and any other function your printer supports. Okay, I'm going to close Word. I'm going to go back to BOPF 8. And before I conclude, if you're wondering whether I had some special souped-up computer for this demonstration, I didn't. It's one of the oldest computers in our lab. It's a straight-out-of-the-box 6-year-old gateway, all-in-one, running Windows 7. So a newer computer or a newer operating system will just make it that much better. Finally, and very quickly, there's one more cool thing I want to show you. Let's say a client comes into the office and says that they received an updated bank account statement. Here's how quickly it can be fixed. Let's go to the asset worksheet. Bank account is in there. Where is bank account? Discover CD. Let's try that one. Let's say that the account is supposed to be $6,000 instead of what we have there because it earned more interest. All I've got to do is type in the $6,100. There it is. It's done. All the math, all 20 pages of forms, all the repetitive information, it was all done in that short amount of time it took me to just change that 5 to a 6. And you just can't do that with the court's static web PDF form. So if you've got time to waste, that's okay. Or if you're a layperson or not a law office, that's all right too. But if you're a law office and you're preparing these forms day in and day out, you want to have a program like this that makes those changes that easy. That's it. I know I'm a bit long compared to most of our other demo videos, but there was a bit more to cover. At any rate, I appreciate your viewing, and I wish you the best. Take care.